shake me. I will not be moved. My feet are on the rock. I can feel the waters rise. I can hear the howling lies that haunt me. Fear won't hold me now. My feet are on the rock.
Stand, all of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands. Our feet are on the rock. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground is sinking sand. So stomp your feet and clap your hands.
Give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. When I feel High and all the earth. dwell below the skies. Let the Creator's praise arise. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let the Redeemer's name be sung through every land by every tongue.
Well, welcome in the name of Jesus Christ. Just greet one another for another 3 minutes. Have a good time. Talk. Again, welcome in the name of Jesus Christ. And for those of y'all who are streaming, welcome to our worship service this morning. I am absolutely delighted that you're with us here. We've got some announcements in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. Be aware that the nominating committee is going to be meeting right after church today, and if you have a name that you would like to suggest for the office of either deacon or elder, maybe there's somebody you want to get back at for something they did you and you want to nominate them, This is your opportunity, because the nominating committee is going to be meeting later and kind of finalizing a slate that we'll vote on in December. So be aware of that. Let's see. What's that, Cherry? Noodles. What about noodles? Now, some of y'all I know have been waiting till the very end to noodle. Because you didn't want to spoil yourself by, you know, too much fun is not healthy. You know, so if you've been waiting till the last minute to noodle, this is the day to do it. Monday's your last opportunity. The last opportunity to do it. And I'll tell you, we have, and I'm looking at Van and Peg, we've gotten the time down pretty well. The pickers have got, you know, we've been finishing out pretty fast. What's that? We were finished before 7 last week. So if you want to participate in something like this, we're looking to break records. You know, we're right on the edge. So that's right. That's right. If we could finish by 6:30, man, we'd be cooking. So you want to be aware that noodles, we're going to be finishing noodles on Monday. Okay, thank you. And with all the activities that have flyers, if you want flyers to distribute or post, just let me know, and we can make as many of those as you need. So because we're doing trunk or treat in a little over a week, and so on Monday, that's right, on the 31st. So if you want to post anything for trunk or treat, you know, just tell me, and I can make as many flyers as you need. We can put them all over the place. So just be aware of it. And the forms are right on the little lectern in the hallway for vendors. So if you have anything, if you do anything that's really bizarre, sign up to be a bizarre vendor. Right, you'll fit right in. Also, come to church, you'll fit right in. Any other announcements? Oh, and be aware, one of the reasons I'm coming very intentionally with the microphone is the people who are streaming have a hard time hearing unless you're speaking into the microphone. So you qualify, Shelly. Yeah. You can come. Yeah. Just wear shorts and a My Little Pony shirt. Yeah, and you'll be fine. Okay. Anything else? Is a short in it? If you keep on hitting it? Okay, I heard it. Okay, so when I pass it to somebody, if I just sort of whack them, it'll work.
I would say if you don't hear it working.
Just okay, then that's what you do. Yeah. Any other announcements? Well then, brothers and sisters, as God's people, let's worship Him together. Thank you. Is Amanda around a boat? Oh, in the restroom. Okay, then we'll wait. And when she comes back, please give her a round of applause. Because we don't want to make her feel uncomfortable. There she is! Yay! No, that's great. That's a need, a definite need. Let's sing together, "This Is My Father's World."
This is my Father's world, and to my listening ears, all nature sings and round my rings the music of the spheres. This is my Father's world. I rest me in my thought of rocks and trees, of skies and seas. His hand the wonders wrought. This is my Father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning light, the lily white, declare the maker's praise. My Father's world, he shines in all that's fair. In rustling grass I hear him pass, he speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me ne'er forget that thought, though wrong, seems of so strong. God is the ruler yet. This is my Father's world. The battle is not done. Jesus, who died, shall be satisfied, and earth and heaven be one.
And together let's sing, "Precious Lord, Take My Hand."
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me to hand. Precious Lord, lead me home. When my gray grows dim, precious Lord, linger near. When my light is almost gone, precious Lord, lead me home.
Thank you so much. Y'all be seated. And would young people, would y'all come on up here, if you would? Come on, girls. My goodness, how y'all doing? Good to see you. Yeah, have a seat up here. Now you're not the only boy. That's good. That's good. But we kind of separated, right? We got boys on our right side, and we got girls on our left side, and we've got in the middle? Nobody. Yeah, nobody there in the middle. All right. Anything new or exciting happened this week? Anything big? And I'm talking about big. Yeah, that's pretty big. Halloween party. Where did you have it? At your house or at the studio? At the rec center. Okay. I've never been to a Halloween party for a long time. What did you do at your Halloween party? You played ball? Like basketball? The boys took all the room in the gym. Well, see, that's what boys do. You know, you got to get used to that because boys will do that. But one thing you want to remember, ladies, and I'm going to tell you this. Y'all just do it. You're smarter than the boys. Trust me. Being a boy, I know. So, you had anything else happen? So, had a wedding party, anything else interesting happen this last week? That you would write in your diary, say, dear diary, this happened last week? No, nothing. Yeah, just nothing. Okay, you don't have a diary, so that was a silly thing to say. Okay, well, I'll tell you, I've got a little story for you today. Little story. Because we're kind of looking at stories during the service. Stories that Jesus told, and they call parables. And a parable is really just a story that has a meaning. And the parable we're going to look at is, it's about a guy who had two sons. And we're going to just talk about one of them. He's a father and had two sons. And how do you think he feels about his sons? Your potential parents. How do you think you feel about having a son? Yeah, well, that's... I'm thinking, Lord have mercy. It'll be maybe 12 years at least. Now, when you're a parent and you have a... How do you feel about your son? How do you think you'll feel about your son? How does your dad feel about you? Sons and daughters. Does your father like you? Yeah, hope. Oh, maybe a little bit. That's what we live with. We live with hope. Yeah. So where this father loved his son. Loved his son. Thought his son was the greatest guy around. Okay? And the boy grew up. And he said to his father thought he was great, right? And the son said to him, Daddy, I want you to give me a bunch of your money. And the father says, why do you want a bunch of my money? And he says, well, you know I'm entitled to it because I'm your son, and I'm going to take that money and do what I want with it. And his father said to him, now I know what my father would have said to me. What would my father have said to me? When he stopped laughing, he'd have said, no chance. But this father said, well, you know something, son? You are entitled to half the money I have, so I am going to give you half the money that I have. And the son said, okay, I'll take it. And he took the money, and you know what he did with the money? He went and blew it on junk. Like, what kind of stuff? If you had a bunch of money, what's some kind of junk you could buy? How could you waste it? You would buy clothes. That's what he did. He bought a whole bunch of clothes. Yeah. Bought a whole lot of candy. His teeth just rotted out. It was awful. So he had, but he looked good. He looked good, but his teeth were all rotten out. What else would you do if you had a whole bunch of money? You buy candy, you buy clothes. What would you get? Get more clothes. What would you get?
I would get the most expensive horse in the entire
world. He, you know, funny you mention it. He got the most expensive horse around. Named it Flecker. The horse. What would you do if you had a bunch of money?
Buy a hot tub.
Buy a hot tub. That's what he did. He had a hot tub, and in the hot tub he was eating candy. And wearing his new clothes, which was kind of stupid. That was kind of stupid because the clothes got all wet and shrunk. His horse was in there too. And what would you do with your money? You threw a party. Who would you invite to your party? Just two people at your party? Include your family. Include your family. Christmas is coming. Include your family. Trust me. All right, so you'd have a party, right? What would you, if you had a whole bunch of money, what would you spend it on? Buy toys. Oh, that's yours. You're speaking for her. She would buy toys. What would you buy? You'd buy clothes too? Okay, so we got a lot of clothes and horses in the hot tub. So that's what he did, but he blew all his money, you see? And when you got no money, you know, when you spend it all on clothes, candy, hot tubs, and horses, what do you need to live?
A house.
You need a house, right? You need food and you need water. And he was drinking the water in the hot tub, and that was bad, you know? And all he had to eat was candy, and his teeth were all rotten out. I know. And he was spitting out the chlorine. It was awful. And, you know, the horse had been swimming around there. You know, that wasn't good. So he says to himself, he says, man, this is bad news. I think I'll go back to my daddy because my daddy at least has some water that doesn't have chlorine and horse stuff, you know. And so he went back to his dad, but he was really worried because he was afraid his dad was going to say what? What do you think his dad... What was he afraid his dad might say to him? Absolutely not, you can't come home. Why would his dad do that? Because he didn't treat his dad very good, right? So he was afraid of that. So he goes home and he gets this little speech. And he's going to say, Daddy, I did the wrong thing and I am so sorry. Take me back and I'll live in the shed in the back of the house, backyard. At least give me some water and food and new clothes. He still was like new. He had a lot of clothes anyway. Yeah, he could put them in the dryer. That's right, because they were wet from the hot tub. And when he got home, he was all worried because he thought his daddy was going to kick him out. But instead of kicking him out, you know what his daddy said?
What?
He said, come on home, son. I've been missing you. Because I love you that much. I thought I had lost you, but here you are. And that makes me, huh? Yeah, well, he had gone way away and he came back. And he said, I thought I'd lost you and never see you again. And now you're home. And we're going to see us, what's that? Yeah, he was in the backyard. But his daddy said, no, you take the room that you used to sleep in. I'm going to give you your room back. And your bed and your stuff is right where you left it. I'm taking you back home. And that's the story we're going to look at today. And we're going to talk about how God is like our Father and how He loves us that much. And even when we do things that aren't very nice, God still loves us. So let's have a word of prayer. And then my assistant will bring up some things for you to fill out. So let's bow our heads and have a prayer. Lord God, thank you for loving us as much as you do. And thank you for always providing a home for us. No matter where we go or what we do, you still have a home for us. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Here. You need the other one. Here. 100 of them. I don't have 100. Now, you want to share that with you. You don't want to share it, okay? I just have. I'm sorry. I'll pray for you later. I hope he lets you go into the hot tub when he gets that hot tub. All right. Now, gather around.
I'll be here.
Okay. And now I want you all to have an outstanding week. And what do I want you to remember all week long?
God loves us. And happy Halloween.
That's it. Well, we come now to the part of the service when we have the opportunity to lift our prayers to God. Now, we've got some needs in the bulletin of which you may want to take note. There's an addition. We want to remember to pray for our brother Dwayne Quinn. And Jess, is that your dad? Okay, how's he doing? He has Parkinson's. Sure. I understand that.
But that's one of the hardest things.
Sure. Just limited. He can't do things that he loved doing. So we'll lift him up in our prayers. So, are there other needs and concerns we want to remember today and into the next week? Good. I think that deserves a amen. That's awful good news. So that's certainly a reason to praise. Anything else we want to remember today and into the next week? Well, then let's go to God in prayer. And since we're going to be hearing God's word read and proclaimed in just a little bit, part of the prayer will be confession so that we're prepared to hear that. And then there'll be some silence for y'all to lift up these concerns. And then we'll close with the Lord's Prayer. So let's go before God now in prayer. Lord God, before we say anything else, we got to give you a big word of thanks. My goodness gracious, you've given us a drop-down gorgeous day. And for that, we are really appreciative. You've also given us a community here in which you are present and we can feel your spirit moving. And we are guided together to do the work you've called us to do. And for that, we give you praise and thanks as well. Before we hear your word read and proclaimed, though, there's something we need to confess. Lord, you heard the story I was telling the kids, and that's really one of the based on the parable we're looking at today. But you know that that's only half the story, because in the rest of that story, the rest of that parable, we've got an older brother who... is not happy about how the father has received his younger son. Feels resentment, feels anger, and fails to celebrate his brother's return. Now, you know that because that's the story your son told us. And you know, sometimes we act an awful lot like that older son. We kind of try to put limits to your grace and your love, and we say that it only applies to people who live in certain places and who do certain things and who think certain thoughts. that we're going to limit your grace to just those, forgetting that we're talking about your grace, not our grace. And when we see those that we don't think belong, we feel resentment towards them, but we also feel resentment towards you as we try to control you, as we try to remake you in our image. And when we do that, we lose touch with who you actually are. And so we ask for your forgiveness when that happens, Lord. And we ask that you enable us to have a vision that's broader than what we already see. We ask that you help us hear things that we would normally shut out and reach out to folks that we'd prefer to push away. Help us to do that because that's what you do. We ask this in the name of Christ. And now in the privacy of our own hearts, we're going to lift up to you the concerns that we heard shared. We're going to lift up to you those needs that are in the bulletin. And we're going to lay before you all those things that weigh heavy on our heart. Lord God, hear us now as we pray. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for listening to us. And of course, thank you for loving us as much as you do. But right now, Lord, thank you for forgiving us. And we believe that we've been forgiven. We also thank you for responding to our needs. And we know that you'll do that because we've lifted these concerns up to you in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, would the ushers come up and collect our offering?
Run. And then he ran said my son's come home again, lifting my face, wipe the tears from my eyes with forgiveness in his voice. He said, son, do you know I still love you? I was so ashamed, all alone and so far away, but now I know
Let's have a word of prayer. Lord God, thank you for giving us the means by which we can make this offering to you. Guide and direct the leaders of this congregation that these gifts may be put to good and effective use. In the name of Christ we pray, amen. Now, I've got to tell you something. I find northwestern Pennsylvania weather absolutely fascinating. Now, you got to understand, I have lived in quite a few places. Quite a few places. And whether it's South Louisiana or Eastern Montana, folks who live there always say the exact same thing. Same thing. If you don't like the weather around here, what's the rest of it? Yeah, just wait 5 minutes and it'll change. Now, they all say that. But I got to tell you, moving from snow on Wednesday and the low 30s to the low 70s and sunshine, that's impressive. Of course, everybody here knows the warm temperature is not going to last. As a matter of fact, right now, we may be experiencing the last gasp of summer. Although, if you don't like the weather around here now, well, you know the rest of that. Anyway, on this bright, warm Sunday morning, on a day where you could be doing something else outside, I am delighted that you are here and streaming. As we look at another one of the parables found only in the Gospel of Luke. That's what we started the series last week. And last week, we looked at the first of the parables in Luke, and it was what? You remember what that was? Oh, this is one of those affirming moments for a preacher or a teacher. It's a Good Samaritan. Thank you very much. The Good Samaritan. We talked about how you might never really know what it means to love your neighbor until you intentionally put yourself in the position of someone who desperately needs help. Now, that was what we did last Sunday. And today we're going to be looking at another parable that, like the Good Samaritan, is probably familiar to folks both within and outside the church. And I'm talking about the parable of the lost or the what? Prodigal son, right? Now, that's what it's called. But, you know, I'm not sure that that's the best title for this particular story. You see, saying that it's about a wayward son sort of encourages us to concentrate our attention on his actions, when I think the focus really should be on the father. And I'll tell you, that's what we're going to do this morning. We're going to look at what the father did within this story. And we're going to use that to sort of shape how we might respond to our Heavenly Father. And to do that, I'll break this message into three parts. First, we're going to look at the context for the parable itself. Second, we're going to look at the parable. And then third, we're going to look at the application, you know, how we might apply the story to our own lives. Now, that's the plan. And, you know, it all starts with establishing the context. And in the case of this particular parable, it's what came before, because I got to tell you, nothing happens after, at least related to this particular story. Now, this is what the evangelist Luke wrote. He wrote, "Tax collectors and sinners were all crowding around listening to Jesus. So the Pharisees and the teachers of the law of Moses started grumbling. This man is friendly with sinners. He even eats with them." Then Jesus told them this story. "If any of you has 100 sheep and one of them gets lost, what will you do? Won't you leave the 99 in the field and go look for the lost sheep until you find it? And when you find it, you will be so glad that you will put it on your shoulder and carry it home. Then you're going to call your friends and neighbors and say, 'Let's celebrate, I found my lost sheep.' Jesus said, in the same way, there is more happiness in heaven because of one sinner who turns to God than over 99 good people who don't need to." Jesus told the people another story. "What will a woman do if she has 10 silver coins and loses one of them? Won't she light a lamp, sweep the floor, and look carefully until she finds it? Then she will call her friends and neighbors and say, 'Let's celebrate, I have found my lost coin.' Jesus said, in the same way, God's angels are happy when even one person turns to him." Now that's what Luke wrote right before the parable of the prodigal son. And let's take just a minute to think about what's happening here. I mean, we've got a situation, right? Right at the beginning. Who do we have gathered there? Who does Jesus mention? Well, we got tax collectors and we've got sinners, right? And we've also got a whole bunch of Pharisees and teachers of the law, lawyers. Since Cass isn't here, I'll call them that. In other words, they are the most moral guys in town. And what are they doing? They are grumbling. And they're grumbling about the tax collectors and the sinners who have all gathered around Jesus. And it ticks them off because they are what you would call the lowlives in ancient Judea. And since it seems as though their moral indignation prompted Jesus to act, the fact that they were grumbling got Jesus talking, I think we can assume that what he had to say was related to their attitude, right? But I want you to notice that Jesus, after this encounter, man, he didn't go right into the parable of the prodigal, did he? Instead, our story is sort of like Return of the Jedi. It is the last installment in a trilogy, with two very short parables coming before, one dealing with a shepherd and a lost sheep, and the other one dealing with a woman and a lost coin. And since Jesus told these three, one right after the other, I think it is reasonable to assume that they all have the same lesson intended for those grumbling Pharisees, especially since at least the first two have almost the exact same structure. I mean, in each of these two stories that provide a context for the parable of the prodigal, we've got a story about a person who has lost something, right? And about what he did or she did to find it, and about how they rejoiced when it was found. And then for each one, Jesus offered a lesson, didn't he? There was a lesson at the end of each of the little stories, that God does the same thing when one person turns to him and is found. Something that was directly related to all the sinners and tax collectors who were gathering around Jesus, who were turning to him. Folks who caused the religious people to start grumbling. Now, that's the context for the parable of the lost son. And I'll tell you, for that reason, it's really not surprising that when you look at the first half of the parable, and I'm talking about the one we're looking at this morning, the pattern we saw with the shepherd finding the lost coin and the woman, or the shepherd finding the lost sheep and the woman finding the lost coin, the structure is the same, at least in the first half of the parable of the prodigal. Just listen to what Jesus said. Jesus told them yet another story. Once a man had two sons. The younger son said to his father, "Give me my share of the property." So the father divided his property between his two sons. Not long after that, the younger son packed up everything he owned and left for a foreign country, where he wasted all his money in wild living. Doesn't say it, but probably horses and hot tubs. He had spent everything when a bad famine spread through the whole land. Soon he had nothing to eat. He went to work for a man in that country, and the man sent him out to take care of his pigs. He would have been glad to eat what the pigs were eating, but no one gave him a thing. Finally, he came to his senses and said, "My father's workers have plenty to eat, and here I am starving to death. I will go to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against God in heaven and against you. I am no longer good enough to be called your son. Treat me like one of your workers.'" The younger son got up and started back to his father. But when he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt sorry for him. He ran to his son and hugged him and kissed him. The son said, "Father, I have sinned against God in heaven and against you. I am no longer good enough to be called your son." But his father said to his servant, to the servants, "Hurry and bring the best clothes and put them on him. Give him a ring for his finger and sandals for his feet. Get the best calf and prepare it so that we can eat and celebrate. This son of mine was dead but has come back to life. He was lost and has now been found." And they began to celebrate. Now, that's the first half of the third parable. And like I said, I think it pretty much follows the same structure as the other two. For example, it's focused on a person who lost something, right? And in this case, he lost his what? He lost his son. A father lost his son. And although it really didn't involve the father actively looking, his son sort of finds himself and returned to his father. And then it ended with great rejoicing, didn't it? I mean, the father runs out and he greets the prodigal with hugs and kisses. He gets a new suit of clothes and puts it on his boy and prepares for him a fancy feast and not the kind you'd give to a cat. And then said, "This son of mine was dead, but has now come back to life. He was lost and now has been found." You see, just like the first two, there was losing and finding and celebrating. Something that Jesus already said God does when the lost are found. But you know, it's right here, and this I find interesting, it's right here where Jesus throws those Pharisees and teachers of the law, it's where right here he throws them a curve. You see, based on what he has already said, in the first two parables he gave, they probably expected Jesus to offer a lesson, right? Because that's what he'd done twice before. They expected him to make the same point for the third time. You know, that this is how God reacts in heaven when the lost are found. I mean, he's already done it twice. We'd expect him to do that again. But that's not what he did, is it? Instead of just telling those guys what it meant, what this story meant, Jesus did something that I think is really cool. Man, it's really cool. He sort of brought them into the parable itself. And if you remember what we talked about last week, he did the exact same thing with the with the parable of the Good Samaritan. And I'll tell you, when we grumble about folks coming to Jesus, who are just as unacceptable for us as sinners and tax collectors were unacceptable to Pharisees. When we look at them and all we can see are their clothes and their backgrounds. All we can see is their values and their opinions. All we can see is, my gosh, their lifestyle and the language they choose to use. When those things blind us to their decision to come to Jesus Christ, and so we grumble about them being here with us and having the audacity to call themselves Christians, maybe Jesus is bringing us into the parable too when he says this. The older son had been out in the field. But when he came near the house, he heard the music and dancing. So he called one of the servants over and asked, "What's going on here?" The servant answered, "Your brother has come home safe and sound. And your father ordered us to kill the best calf." The older brother got so angry that he would not even go into the house. His father came out and begged him to go in. But he said to his father, "For years I have worked for you like a slave and have always obeyed you. But you've never even given me a little goat so that I could give a dinner for my friends. This other son of yours wasted your money on prostitutes. And now he's come home. And you ordered the best calf to be killed for a feast." The father replied, "My son, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we should be glad and celebrate. Your brother was dead, but now he's alive. He was lost, and now he's been found." You see, while the father was celebrating his child coming home, the older brother couldn't get past himself. He couldn't get past his opinions of and his feelings about his younger brother. And we all know how we feel about our younger brothers. Right, Reese? And in this case, it was a younger brother who had actually done everything he was accused of doing. Man, he just couldn't pull an Elsa and let it go. And so he resented the actions of his father, didn't he? He resented them. The one for whom he had worked like a slave and always obeyed. You see, he resented that his father had shown his brother grace and mercy and compassion and had given his brother more than he deserved. I mean, instead of bringing down the hammer and treating him like one of the workers, you know, instead of showing him, I love this, tough love, and blind justice, his father threw his younger son, now get this, the one who had ripped him off, threw him a party. And that wasn't fair, not to the older brother. And I'll tell you, because of that, the older son couldn't or wouldn't share in his father's joy. Instead, he stood outside the house, all mad and angry. I'm sure that showed his father. Probably grumbling about how he'd been slighted by a man who was going to give him everything he had. And that's where the story ends. And there they were. Those scribes and those lawyers and those Pharisees, wondering how the actions and the attitude of that older son and the love of the father applies to them. You see, unlike what Jesus did in the other two parables, he never told them what it meant. They had to figure that out on their own. Of course, they're not the only ones left to decide about the application. You see, if we feel as though Jesus may be talking about us when he described the older son, maybe just a little bit, well, then I think we have a few questions that we probably need to ponder, right? For example, knowing that God celebrates when the lost are found, when all the lost are found, maybe we should ask ourselves if we're willing to put aside some of our assumptions and prejudices about folks that we believe are and should always be on the outside. They're the ones we call them. They're the ones we call them. You know, if we're willing to put aside our opinions about where they should stand within the body of Christ, and about what they should receive from God. Because if we were God, we sure wouldn't give them any grace. We'd show them tough love. Exactly what they deserve. Are we willing to put those assumptions aside? Now that's one question, but that's not all. Maybe we should also ask ourselves if we're willing to accept God's unconditional love for both us and for them. You know, to accept that since Jesus came to save who? Who did Jesus come to save? Sinners. Salvation is beyond the limits that we would set. And that since God has every right to be generous with the things that belong to him, grace and mercy are not ours to control. Are we willing to accept God's love? Now that's another question. And finally, maybe we should ask ourselves if we're willing to celebrate with our Lord when the lost are found. I mean, are we willing to enter the party? Are we going to stand outside? A party with all those who have always been on the outside but now have come in. In other words, to enter into a new relationship with God that's grounded on his will and not our wants. And to enter into a new relationship with one another. One that will enable us to reach out to everyone who trusts in God so that together we can reach out to everyone in our world who might feel physically and emotionally and, my goodness gracious, spiritually lost. Brothers and sisters, are we willing to celebrate with the lost who've been found? Now, in light of what Jesus said, I think these are three questions we really need to answer. And you know, when we do, I believe we'll be applying this parable to ourselves. Although it may really be nice today, I think we'd all agree that some colder weather is going to be coming sooner than later. Am I not right? Now, that's just something we know, isn't it? This is the way it is. And as we leave here this morning, thanks to the story Jesus offered, a bunch of Pharisees who grumbled because the wrong kind of people were coming to Jesus, the wrong kind of people. We also know that in spite of what we think or what we may want, God rejoices whenever the lost are found. He just does. And that we need to decide whether or not we're going to put aside our assumptions and accept God's unconditional love and to celebrate with him and with them. You see, I think this is the decision we have to make when we listen to the parable of the lost son. Amen. Let's pray together. Lord God, thank you for this wonderful, wonderful parable. Because not only do you give us an assurance that's absolutely incredible, that you are not some cold, distant, unconcerned God, but that you rejoice when the lost are found. You rejoice when people turn to you. That makes you happy. Thank you. But also remind us that the people who make you happy may not be the same that make us happy. The ones that we may not want to accept. The ones that we may push to the side. Help us to push not them to the side, but some of our assumptions and prejudices. And help us to accept the richness of your incredible and unconditional love. And then help us to celebrate. Help us to go into the house and help us to party down with you and with all those who were lost, but who have been found. Help us to do that in the name of Christ. Amen. Now, before we close the service by singing the last hymn, let me offer to you all this invitation. If there's anybody here who might feel the grace of Jesus Christ, the love of God, just talk to me after the service. Be delighted to talk to you about that. If you've got a question about the sermon or the service, I would be delighted to talk to you about that as well. Heck, Debbie is in Morgantown. I got nothing to do. But take a nap. So let's all stand up. And Amanda, if you would come up here, if you would, and let's sing together, God Will Take Care of You. Yes.
I said, Cass is here.
Oh. Oh, you were up in heaven. Oh, that's. I thought you were pointing at the monitor. When did you get here, Cass? Did you hear the crack about the lawyer?
Yes.
Okay. You're meeting up there. Yes. And since that's coming from on high, I think if you're on the committee, you should go. Right? Brothers and sisters, go now in peace. Whoa, that'll sober you up when you hear God talking to you from the balcony. Brothers and sisters, go now in peace. And be challenged. Be challenged to recognize that God celebrates when the lost are found. And also be challenged to be willing to celebrate too. And to empower this walk, receive the blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And the people of God said, Amen.